This one's going to be about the U.S. Constitution. The basic theme of my video here is going to be the fact that the U.S. Constitution was not adopted or passed in order to protect or enhance Americans' liberties. Now, most people in this country and outside this country, you know, those who bothered to even look into this, usually conflate the two. You know, the American ideal of, you know, a society where, you know, freedom is dominant is usually conflated with the Constitution. The Constitution is the thing that protects those liberties. I want to argue that that's not the case. In fact, if you look at how the Constitution was passed, if you look at, you know, the principles driving its drafting and adoption, the whole process of, you know, how it came to be that the U.S. lives under the Constitution now, and even the mere fact that I just said U.S. lives, whereas United States used to be plural, it used to refer to a collection of sovereign and independent entities, the states, and the fact that we're using it in singular now as opposed to plural, that also came to be as a result of, you know, the adoption of the Constitution. So I want to, it's going to be a little long, I guess. I'm not sure how long it's going to take me. And I put together a few notes, so I'm going to be looking at them and, you know, as I'm talking to you about these things. So what I want to do is, first of all, you know, when we talk about liberties, I want to define what those liberties are. And that should be pretty obvious to most of my subscribers. By the way, this video is probably not going to tell you anything new or anything that you don't know. You know, maybe a couple of interesting facts here and there, but you know, if you're you know, in favor of a stateless society, if you're an anarchist, then this is not going to be some kind of groundbreaking revelation for you. But I think this, and in fact, this is a result of an effort that I undertook at a certain point to talk to some people that I know. Of, you know, a different persuasion. They're not anarchists, but they are, you know, generally open to the idea of freedom. And this was an exercise that I undertook in order to try and convince them that things are not what they seem in terms of the present American reality and American history and other, you know, other things. So I guess the market for this video, the best market for this video, the intended market, is really minarchists and constitutionalists and fans of the American idea in principle. Fans of the idea that the way to live in a society with freedom and dignity is to be America. Be America, or do what America did. And I want to you know, make a case that that's not so. You know, in a lot of respects. So anyway, we're going to go over what liberties we're talking about. We're going to demonstrate the difference between the American Revolution as a concept and the U.S. Constitution, because the two are too often conflated, and that's a bad thing. So we're going to discuss the difference between Revolution and Constitution. We're also going to talk about what was there before the Constitution. How did Americans get by without the Constitution? We're going to talk about some of the central persons behind the drive to adopt the Constitution. What those people believed, what they did, you know, talk about their ambitions, talk about their philosophies, and, you know, views of the world. And I'm going to give a theory that I think is pretty well backed up by facts of the main forces and drivers that were behind the adoption of the Constitution. We're going to talk about the actual process. That's actually a very interesting topic that does not discuss too much, and I think deserves much more attention than it's getting. The actual process of the drafting and ratification of the Constitution, that's extremely interesting, and I would believe that a vanishingly small percentage of Americans even know anything about how that happened, apart from, you know, the fact that it happened in Philadelphia and there was a convention. And we're also going to talk a little bit about the opposition to the Constitution at the time. Then we're going to look at the new powers that the Constitution granted, the new central government that it created, and quickly look at the results of all that. And by the end of this discussion, I hope that you, my minarchist friends, are at least going to feel that you have a good reason to rethink some of the things you've been taking for granted for a long time. Okay, so I'm not going to cite a lot of direct sources. I mean, I'm going to cite some sources, but I'm not going to provide. This is not a scholarly article. You know, narrated as a spoken word. But this is more a perspective. All of these sources obviously exist and they can be easily looked up. And if you're interested, contact me. I'll try to give you what I have in terms of links and books to, you know, that I recommend to read and so forth. But this is going to be a high-level overview, as it were. So what liberties do we mean? We mean, you know, I mean individual liberties to, in my understanding, which is informed by sort of the Rothbardian perspective, liberty simply means the ability to dispose of yourself, your own personal energies, your body, and your property. So it would include owning property, to dispose of it as you see fit. Outside of you aggressing against similar freedoms of other people. That's liberty we're talking about. So, you know, we're not talking about, you know, freedom to kidnap or freedom to murder or freedom to rape, because those freedoms, quote unquote, would entail, you know, me or you or whoever tries to exercise them would entail aggressing against freedoms of other people, freedoms and claims to live a free life without being molested by others. So we're talking about, you know, just living your life, doing what you please, with this, you know, with the stuff that you own, with your body, with your life, with your time, with your energy. You know, pointing a gun at someone to mug them is not freedom. It's aggression against the freedom of others. Freedom that they have a right to, I believe, not to be aggressed against, not to have a gun pointed at them, and, you know, not to have threatened by force and forced to fork over their property. So very, very, very simply, you know, in the context of a political philosophy, it's you know, this concept of liberty that I'm discussing is, you know, something that supports the idea of a voluntary society where the arrangements people make amongst themselves are voluntary. They're not backed by coercion, and coercion is not a and by coercion we mean, you know, use of physical force, a threat of physical force. The coercion is not used as a mechanism to achieve ends. And in that regard, we have to understand that the power of government and the scope of the governmental power is in inverse relationship to the scope of personal freedom, because government, as we're discussing it here, and I'm going to end up using the words government and state interchangeably, and that's not quite you know, very strict in terms of, you know, if you're a philosopher, but for the purposes of this discussion, I think it's going to be sufficient. So government, as we know it, is physical force, okay? Law and government, as we know it, is physical force. Laws are not suggestions, they're not guidelines, they're, you know, they're not recommendations. They are enforced at the point of a gun. And when we speak of government, we speak of an entity that does the enforcing and also does the legislating. It creates rules. In our case, government creates rules and then enforces compliance with those rules. So that entity, that government, is physical force, plain and simple. When we have a tax code, that's not a set of guidelines, how much money you should donate to this entity called government. No. That's not that at all. Obviously, and if you want to discover that laws are in fact enforced at the point of a gun in a very, very literal sense, try not paying your taxes. Consistently not paying your taxes. Resisting the state's authority, resisting the state's attempts to extract that money from you. Just try to do that consistently. You'll see what happens. The guns are going to come out very quickly. You will indeed discover that you don't have a freedom not to pay. And if you resist consistently, what's going to happen is, again, you're probably going to, you know, have some letters first, and then, you know, when you, you know, leave those letters without response for weeks and months, then they will start calling your house and trying to talk to you. And if you ignore them or just tell them, you know, to go shove it, they're going to show up at your place. Well, they may not do that, you know, as first resort. They may try and freeze your bank account from a distance. But eventually, they will show up, and they will try to take that property that they think is yours, your money. Let's say you've moved all your money out of your checking account in the bank. There's nothing to freeze. Well, then they will come for your physical assets to your place of living. And if you resist them then, because they will try to arrest you, put handcuffs on you, shove you in the back of a police car, and drive you off to jail. And if you resist them then, they will kill you. I mean, if you resist them consistently, imagine a group of people coming to your house. You don't know them. They are not wearing a uniform for which you have respect or whatever. They aren't waving a piece of paper that says warrant on it. They just come to your house. knock on the door, try to break down the door to take you forcibly out of your house and drive off to some location where you don't want to go. You would obviously resist them. You know, if you own firearms, you would probably resist them with fire. You will probably point a gun at them and say, beat it or I'll shoot. If you do that with the police, they will shoot you, they will kill you, and they will get away with it. And everybody's going to think that they were in the right and you were in the wrong. That's the institution we're talking about, the government, the institution that's allowed to do that. Again, this unnamed gang of thugs showing up at your house, they're, you know, we don't know who they are, but whoever it is, we think, you know, doing something like that is totally legitimate, and whoever resists them has the full right to do so. Not if they're wearing a uniform, and not if they're, you know, have a badge clipped to their chest, and not, or to their belt, and not if they're waving a piece of paper that says arrest warrant on it. So for that group of people, it suddenly becomes legitimate, because people give legitimacy to government. Okay, government in their eyes can legitimately take your property and do other things, regulate business, for example, you know, tell you how you can and cannot do business, how you can and cannot dispose of your property. They collect real estate taxes on your house. Do you think you own your house? No. You know, if anything, you know, you may think you own it, but, you know, if you stop paying property taxes, you will quickly discover that this property will be taken away from you in the way that the majority of the society around you believes is totally legitimate, and you will find yourself without a home very quickly. Or maybe not very quickly, but eventually you will. You will. There's no doubt about that. So again, government is force. We already discussed that liberty that we're trying to protect here, and we're discussing whether the Constitution does in fact protect it, is that freedom from that coercion, from that force. So from that perspective, it's clear then that freedom includes and means essentially freedom from government. Maybe it's one of the most important aspects. Freedom from government is the personal liberty we're referring to. So if government gets more freedom to do with you what it wants, then you have less freedom to do with yourself what you want. So they're in an inverse relationship. Therefore, if we can show that government powers have expanded, government powers over individuals have expanded as a result of the adoption of the U.S. Constitution, I think we have shown that the Constitution resulted in the diminishment of personal liberties. Okay, that was a long tangent and probably unnecessary for most of the people watching this, but you know, bear with me. So on to the next point. Revolution and Constitution are not the same thing. Not the same thing. They, you know, they're often conflated in a lot of people's minds, and that's very regrettable as far as I'm concerned. They were accomplished at different times. The revolution occurred in... The revolution, well, it occurred over a long period of time, but it concluded in 1783. And the Constitution was adopted in 1789 and fully ratified by 1791. So we had 8 years. After the revolution had won, until the Constitution was in place. And also, those two things were accomplished by two different sets of people. They were not the same people. The Revolutionary War was fought by the majority of the population. Now, not everybody. You know, you had a lot of royalists, you have a lot of Tories, a lot of people sitting on the fence who only joined the revolutionary forces when it was inevitable. Some people left. Some people left for Canada, some people left for England. So not everybody fought. But by and large, I think it's safe to say that the majority of the U.S. population at the time wanted to secede and participated in the revolution and in the Revolutionary War. They actually wanted to secede, and they supported the activities that brought that about. The Constitution is a different story. There was no popular movement, grassroots movement, to adopt the Constitution. There was no widespread public sentiment or a grassroots push of any sort. It was initiated, proposed, written, pushed through the convention, by a very small, in fact, a really tiny and powerful and connected group of politicians, lawyers, and elite businessmen of the U.S. Eastern Seaboard. That's the fact. Again, not a majority or any sort of widespread grassroots push. It was the very definition of special interest, if you will. It was a very small group, right, that created the Constitution, pushed it through, and made its enactment possible, and then reap the benefits, as we will see. In fact, many prominent Revolutionary War veterans were passionately against the Constitution, which is an interesting fact, I think. There was a lot of opposition, not enough, apparently, because it won, but there was opposition, and a lot of the people who fought in the Revolution were opposed to the Constitution for
very, you know, for reasons very similar to the ones that drove them to participate in the revolution in the first place a few years earlier. So, again, not a result of widespread popular demand, but it was a political maneuver by a special interest group. This is not a controversial fact at all, okay? This is not something that should even be argued about. This is a very clear fact. So let's not conflate the revolution with the Constitution. The revolution was not fought for the Constitution. It was fought for independence and secession from Great Britain, okay? And a different set of people, a number of years later, created the Constitution. So separate those two out in your mind. Now, what was there before the Constitution? Between 1781 and 1789, the 13 newly independent states existed in what would probably be best called a loose confederation under the first Constitution. Yes, the current federal Constitution was not the first Constitution in America. The first Constitution was called the Articles of Confederation. The Articles did create a central government, although it was a far less powerful central government than the one we know and love today. For example, it couldn't collect taxes from Americans, couldn't raise troops directly, couldn't conscript people. It could only requisition those things, both troops, so manpower, and also money, from the state governments. It was, in that regard, a federal government. What it means is, if you're talking about a federal government, its subjects are not individual Americans. Its subjects were governments of sovereign and independent states. And when it demanded something, it couldn't demand it from Americans directly. It demanded it from the governments of those states. And now those governments had direct authority, taxing authority, other types of regulatory authority over the populations of their respective states. That's what a federal government means. What we have now is not a federal government in a strict sense. It's a national government, meaning it has a national scope, but it has direct authority over people, so it's not a federal government. The Federation, as we knew it, is gone. It's dead. It's been dead for, you know, many, 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 many decades. You know, a couple of centuries, actually, almost, depending on, you know, how you count. So federal doesn't mean big or central. National means that. Federal doesn't mean that. And yes, the 13 states were in fact fully sovereign, free, and independent. Which, by the way, brings me to this, the fiction of the American people. If you look at the time of the Revolution and the Constitution, there was no such thing as American people. There were 13 countries which had very different societies. And those societies had very different ways, economically, culturally, temperamentally, even in terms of language, in terms of, you know, diet and eating habits and, you know, clothing. They were very different. They were very, very distinct political societies with different ways of life, different dominant religions, and so forth. So in recognition of those differences, they actually hated each other's guts at times, and at the very least greatly mistrusted each other, which shouldn't be surprising. I mean, look at the feuds that dominated Europe and its history for hundreds of years. You have peoples living next to each other for centuries and centuries and centuries and hating each other's guts. Look at the Balkans. Look at Czechs and Slovaks. Look at Ukrainians and Russians, although it's kind of debatable, but yeah, it's definitely there. To know them is to hate them, sort of thing, right? You know, just because people live on the same continent doesn't mean they have to like each other. And these people definitely didn't. In a lot of ways, they were very mistrustful of each other. If you read about what the Yankees said about Virginians and vice versa, you'll laugh your head off. How incendiary that language was at times. But anyway, I just want to make that point. There was no American people. That was not one people. Those were at least 13 different societies with very different ways of life, different customs, different views of the world, different views of government even, different philosophies and religions dominating there and so forth. So the Articles were there. What did they do? Well, you know, they did create a central government with very limited scope of power, because they wanted it that way. The state governments wanted it that way. They didn't want a central government with a lot of direct authorities over everything and everybody. But in the eyes of some people, that was too weak. You know, it really couldn't do anything. Look, if you're serving in this government, that, you know, my impression has been that, you know, the Continental Congress and the government under the Articles of Confederation were sort of like an advisory committee. I mean, they could make recommendations and they could make demands, but those demands were not met with necessity every single time they were made, you know. So they would requisition troops, and they could get troops or not get troops. They would requisition money, and they would get money or not, depending on whether the states wanted to. And that was how the Constitution was written. That was how the Articles were written. They couldn't force any state to do anything that state didn't want to do. To me, that sounds kind of nice, you know. But the people who were in the central government were obviously not very happy. I mean, what's the point of having a position, if that position gives you little to no power to demand and have it be done, you know? However, to those who say that was very weak, I'd say, well, it was strong enough to win a war. It was strong enough to enable coordination and cooperation between those 13 independent states to win a war and to earn those states independence. And by the way, the King of England, when he released the states, acknowledged the defeat in the war and acknowledged the success of the secession, which we call the Revolutionary War, he listed those 13 states by name as fully sovereign and independent states. In the eyes of the king, he had 13 of what he used to think of as colonies of his crown secede, and, you know, they were recognized by him as independent countries, which is what they were. So anyway, you know, weak or not, of course it was weak, but that was how it was designed, and that was why it was put in place, to be weak. That it wasn't put in place to be strong. And again, the widespread perception was that it was totally fine. You didn't have masses of people suffering because, you know, solely because the central government was, you know, too weak and had a too small scope of authority over them. They were fine. There was no widespread popular movement in America to replace the Articles with anything, you know, different or some kind of new document. And they lived like that for 8 years, and everything was fine for most people. But obviously, for some people, it wasn't fine. And, you know, we're already getting an indication, I hope, that it would be probably the people who had a lot of influence in that central government who would probably not be satisfied 100% with, you know, the scope of power they had, which was not a lot. So I'm going to give you a very, very brief account of a slice of the history at the time. So I'm generalizing a lot here, but it's... My hope is to create a perspective for you to start, you know, your own research and start reading about the events of that time from that perspective. So we have a group that I would call the centralizers, but is generally referred to as Federalists. Influential people that were unhappy with how the Articles came out. And they were unhappy pretty much from the start. And I want to single out Alexander Hamilton as the key representative of that group and the most influential figure at the time of that group. So, okay, so as a young guy, Hamilton was a member of General Washington's staff during the war. He was some kind of personal assistant, whatever. And there are indications that he was a first-class brown noser. He really knew how to get close to people, how to make them like him. Make people like him and trust him. Not necessarily a bad thing, it's just a fact. So he came to be pretty well regarded by Washington during the war. After the war, he got someone, I forget who it was, to introduce him to Robert Morris. Now, Robert Morris was one of the wealthiest people in the country, a very influential Philadelphia merchant. And he wanted to be introduced to Morris because he wanted a job. Now that the war was over, he didn't have really, you know, too many marketable skills, so he was a little worried about his career and what he's going to do for a living. Because he came from very humble origins. He was a bastard child of a family in one of the Caribbean islands, I think. And that family was... Well, he was involved in molasses trade, I think, as a very young man, growing up in a molasses business. But he wasn't rich. He wasn't independently wealthy in any sort of way. So he got somebody to introduce him to Robert Morris, this influential merchant from Philadelphia. And he, he wanted to position himself as an expert in finance. Well, he didn't know anything about finance, so he had someone recommend him a bunch of books. And essentially, he read a couple of finance dictionaries in order to be able to even approach Morris. And he heard he read books, primers, and dictionaries to learn finance. Okay, he was very, very bright, that guy Hamilton. He was very bright, so he absorbed a lot of knowledge, and he wrote a 30-plus page letter to Morris. 30-page letter, handwritten. Can you imagine? 30 pages. Jesus. He really wanted that letter to be effective, I guess. So he wrote a letter to Morris in which he essentially said that he supported every single one of Morris's policy proposals and his views on finance and the organization of the new government and so on and so forth. Now, Morris was an interesting figure. He was actually a pretty sinister figure. There's records of him making enormous amounts of money off of his war contracts during the Revolutionary War. He was part of the secret committee during the war, and he channeled gigantic amounts of money to his own merchant firm, because he was on the committee. He was able to influence where the contracts went for purchase of war supplies, and he channeled them to his firm. And it was estimated that roughly $500,000, and at that time, if you take the price of gold as a rough measure to approximate what it would cost today, we're talking about $40 million in today's dollars. So he channeled $40 million to his own firm through cost-plus contracts. Cost-plus is an interesting, very interesting concept. It works great for defense contractors, where you basically, the government is the buyer, and they guarantee you, okay, so we'll cover your costs, and we'll guarantee you a guaranteed rate of profit, basically. So you have no risk, you have no incentive to constrain costs. In fact, the greater your cost, the greater your absolute profit is going to be, because the percentage is fixed and it's a percentage of an amount. So it's in your interest to grow that amount. So as they say, nice job if you can get it. But that's what he did. So he was essentially a war profiteer, a very cunning, very well politically connected merchant. So Morris received Hamilton and gave him a job. In fact, I think he financed his education. It's kind of like, somebody meets a talented young kid in a ghetto, in the street, and puts him through Harvard, or Yale or something. That's what happened to Hamilton. Hamilton was very smart. He worked very, very hard. Was a workaholic, by contemporary accounts. And so, long story short, the two of them became the leading forces in the nationalist movement. Again, the nationalist movement, the movement to install a national government, a government that's vast in scope. Has direct authority over all the colonies, ex-colonies, now states, populations. So a central government, nationalist government. They were called the Federalists, right? They were calling themselves the Federalists, but the irony is they were actually, set on destroying federalism as a system. They didn't want a federal government. They wanted to undermine the federal government, again, the government whose subjects are governments of independent states in a federation or confederation. They wanted to create a national government, a central government. So they were not federalists at all. They were anti-federalists. But ironically, as it often happens in history, they very cleverly hijacked the term. The people who we know as anti-federalists today were in fact true federalists. They wanted a federal government. They didn't want a national government. And the federalists were the centralizers. They centralized. They were the nationalists. And they were the opposite of federalists. But oh well, we know them under that name. One storyline that I choose to focus on is, has to do with moneyed interest around the time between the victory in the revolution and the adoption of the Constitution. So I'm going to focus on that one story. I'm sure it's not the only story. I know it's not the only story, but I think it's a very interesting and instructive story, and it sheds a lot of light on the motivations of the people who were pushing for a central government. And, to me, it appears to be kind of central to what transpired. So now, war, any war, is an enormous destruction of wealth, right? For one reason, one reason being, while armies fight, they're not working. They're not producing anything, but they're consuming, right? And apart from consuming food, supplies, ammunition, weapons, horses, whatever, horses get killed or die or whatever, horses need to eat, blah, blah, blah. They're destroying stuff as well, as you're fighting A battle, you may end up destroying a town. Well, that town contained some kind of capital. That town contained, you know, houses people could live in, equipment to, you know, farm and to grow food and stuff. So all that gets destroyed. So war destroys wealth. And that was a long war, and a lot of wealth got destroyed. And it's physically gone now. It's gone. The wealth is gone now. How did they... What did the federal government, operating under the Articles, how did they procure all the resources that they needed to fight the war? Well, in different ways. They bought it off the market. They bought it from people. Sometimes they took it by force. Sometimes it was a combination of the two, where they forced a certain price on people who produced the resource. Again, you need to eat. Your army needs to eat. Where are you going to get food? From the people who grow food. Your army needs to be clothed. Where are you going to get the clothes? The people from the people who produce clothes. Well, you know, some of those things were taken. Some of those things were bought. Bought with what? Aha. Bought with what? Well, the government needs to raise money in order to fight wars, right? You need to pay the soldiers something, although, you know, well, you know, the soldiers were paid. You need to pay for the supplies. Even though the soldiers are total volunteers, everybody just wants to fight, doesn't want to be paid. Although, you know, if they were spending their time doing whatever they were doing before in the economy, they would be earning some income. So there's an opportunity cost to them being in the army. But even if we say that every single volunteer is perfectly happy to forego that opportunity cost, just sink it, that's fine. They still need to eat, right? So the government needs to buy all this stuff for them. Buy bullets, muskets, swords, horses, buggies, and you know whatever else they had for means of transportation. How do you raise money for that? Well, the way they did raise money for that was by selling bonds. And we see that repeated in the U.S. history over and over and over again. Every time there's a war, they sell bonds. What is a bond? A bond is a promise to repay a debt, right? So the states issued bonds. The states, which were the entities that raised armies, which was then put together into this American quote-unquote army, because, again, remember, the central government had no authority to raise any armies. They had no authority to tax anybody. States issued a lot of debt. So they were saying, okay, here's a promissory note that you give me 10 golden dollars today, I will pay it back to you after, 5 years after the war is over or whatever. And that debt, any bond, has a face value. And then the holder of that note may choose to hold on to it or sell it to somebody. And let's imagine a situation. You lend somebody money, and you buy a bond from a company or from a government or whatever, and then you have the sneaking suspicion that they may not be able to pay you back. So, for example, you may know that they don't have enough money to pay everybody who holds bonds, so they will pay some people, and others will go unpaid, or they will pay everybody, but they will pay less, a fraction of what they owe, some kind of fraction. So, but you want to get, if there's a risk that you may not get anything, you may want to get at least something for your trouble if you can find a buyer for that bond. And the buyer gets the bond, takes the bond off your hands, and then it's up to them to go after the debtor and collect, if they can, right? What would entice a buyer to buy the debt? I mean, what if I hold a piece of paper that says the government, has promised to pay me, but everybody knows they're going to have a huge problem trying to repay everybody. They simply don't have the money. Remember, that wealth is gone. It's gone. It's been destroyed, physically destroyed, annihilated through the years and years of war. How are they going to repay? Well, we don't know how, but, one thing is certain is, it's much more likely that they're going to, pay less than everything back on that bond. Maybe nothing, maybe a fraction. But it's not very likely that they're going to sell, that they're going to be able to repay the full face value. So people who were holding those bonds realize that the state governments are going to have a huge problem trying to repay in full. And therefore, the price of the bond on the market, the price of those bonds, depreciated to the floor. They were trading at a few percentage points of their face value. If you have a bond note from the state saying, the bearer of this will receive $100 back as a repayment of debt. If you think that there's only 1 in 20 chance that this will actually happen, or even if they pay you, they're going to pay you pennies, then the pennies is what you will be able to sell it for. So they were trading those bonds at like 3 to 5% of their face value. And some people, farmers who went back to their farms or were trying to put their lives back together after the war, after the devastation of the war, they preferred, many of them preferred, to get at least something that was valuable to them at the moment, to get some capital to buy a plow or to buy a horse to rebuild their house or something, to get something back rather than just hold on to this paper and see it just depreciate into zero. So, you know, there was a lot of buying and selling of bonds. The bonds were trading at, like, you know, let's say 5% of their face value, okay? And large portions of those bonds ended up in the hands of a relative few, you know, richer people, most of them, or many of them, politically very connected people, ended up buying a lot, you know, large quantities of those bonds. Well, now imagine you're a Massachusetts state government, for example, right? You have all this outstanding debt. How are you going to repay it? Well, how do you get your money in the first place? By one method, and that's taxing people. So you're going to have to raise taxes. If you have to raise more money than is operationally required for your cash flow requirements, right? You're going to have to raise your taxes over what there are now to cover those outstanding obligations. And those legislatures started doing exactly that. But the way they went about it was very regressive. And they, since the holders of the bonds were rich people, ended up being rich people because poorer people, a lot of Revolutionary War veterans who held the bonds, let go of them for at least some money in order to be able to you know, invest that money into whatever home economy they had or a farm or whatever. Now the bulk of the bonds was held by rich people. So you're not going to tax rich people to then, you know, repay rich people. It's just not something that makes sense. And legislatures in the states were heavily dominated by mercantile interests, basically, you know, property interests, all the respective states. Most of them are concentrated in larger towns, whereas the former holders of the bonds tended to be rural farmers, you know, far away from Boston or Philadelphia or whatever, you know, just, you know, working on their farm in the countryside. And there was no internet, no radio, no TV, so, you know, for information to travel would take time, substantial time sometimes. So taxes started rising, but they started rising on the poor. And, you know, backcountry farmers were hit the hardest in many events. And there was a lot of paper money circulating, issued by states during the war, but now they were the taxes they were demanding that the people pay had to be paid in hard money. It had to be paid in silver or gold or whatever. So you can imagine what's happening here. So you have, you know, rich people who bought those bonds for pennies on the dollar. Now they want to be repaid. The whole point of buying them was, I would argue, to be paid, to get more for them than they paid for them, right? But in order to do that, the states need to raise taxes, and they will not raise taxes on the very people they're trying to benefit, the holders of bonds. Those holders of bonds would not allow it. So they raised taxes on whoever, you know, it made sense to raise taxes on. And that happened to be a lot of poor people, a lot of farmers. Now, in addition to that, the truth of the matter is that a lot of wealthy people, including Morris, that I mentioned before, a lot of his buddies in Philadelphia and New York, were actually very fond of the British system under which they lived, and many of them prospered. System that we typically call mercantilism, state-granted monopolistic privileges to connected businesses. And they wanted that system in America. Now, a lot of them, you know, didn't start out being revolutionaries. A lot of them were Tories and royalists, and they only switched when, you know, the revolution was underway. But they, what they wanted, though, was not a, you know, a laissez-faire society in America. They wanted the society in which they prospered before the revolution, only now, you know, they could, you know, they were hoping they could get that system in America without the British. But the system they wanted was exactly the same. Now, this is, in fact, what the Americans fought the revolution against. You know, the iconic event of the Boston Tea Party has everything to do with East India Company's tea trade monopoly that people were fearing would be installed on them. Okay? It wasn't just some weird event, the Boston Tea Party. They dumped that tea in the sea because the British were threatening to install the East India Company as a monopoly tea trader on the continent. Well, plus a lot of people like Jefferson, for example, they thoroughly despised the corrupt mercantilist system that the British operated under. So there was, you know, another thing that we need to disambiguate and sort of unpack is the founders. The founders were not one monolithic group. The people who had a hand at forming the first governments and the legislative documents of the what is now United States, were not one monolithic group. There were a lot of different interests in there. And there was a lot of rivalry, and some of that rivalry was pretty darn intense. And the Hamilton-Jefferson rivalry is probably the central example of what I'm talking about here. So Jefferson despised the mercantilist system of the British Empire, whereas Hamilton was completely in love with them. Hamilton and his Federalist friends, and they were openly advocating for it. So from the very beginning, Hamilton agitated for what he called a more energetic government, more energetic than the anemic one that they had under the Articles, that would bestow privileges on his benefactors and his friends, and their businesses. And for that, they would, among other things, need to tax people, other people, to fund their special pet projects. For example, and to pursue, again, to quote Hamilton, imperial glory. He wanted imperial glory for America. He wanted America to become an empire, just as the British were a glorious empire. He wanted America now to become a glorious empire to rival the British, without the British. So, British Empire light, you could call it. So it would be a correct characterization, I think, to call Hamilton the founding father of what we now call crony capitalism. And in fact, his ideological disciples were the Whig Party, most noticeably Henry Clay, and what they advocated came to be termed the American system. And the American system had three main pillars. Forget about the pillars. That's not the point. Henry Clay, and then Lincoln, who was his disciple and was in love with Clay's ideology. Forget all that. That's not what I'm trying to talk about here. To quote a book, I think I'm quoting DiLorenzo here. I'm not sure. I'm pretty sure it's DiLorenzo. Hamilton, and under the influence of the two political theorists most distasteful to Jefferson, namely Hobbes and Hume, was frankly the champion of the Leviathan state, end quote. Think about it for a second. Hamilton was the champion of the Leviathan state. He disrespected people like Jefferson, who believed the primary purpose of government should be the protection of rights to life, liberty, and property, right? And he frequently complained very vocally of, quote, an excessive concern for liberty in public men, and called for a government of more energy. Excessive concern for liberty is something he continually mocked Jefferson for. Think about it. The guy who is the central figure behind the central government that we have today was laughing at Jefferson for his excessive concern with personal freedom in common men. So freedom is okay for him and his buddies, but not for the peasants, not for the rubble. Very, very interesting. But again, if you're a student of history and have read about Hamilton, especially if you've read Tom DiLorenzo's books, that's not surprising to you. But if you haven't read Tom DiLorenzo's books, you should. Okay. Now, Clinton Rossiter wrote in his fawning book, Alexander Hamilton and the Constitution, quote, Hamilton had perhaps the highest respect for government of any important American political thinker who had ever lived. The highest respect for government of any important political thinker who ever lived. His overriding purpose, again, to quote Rossiter, and Rossiter was a big fan of Hamilton, so we can't accuse him of giving a biased account. If it's biased, it's the other way. It's biased in favor of Hamilton. His overriding purpose, to quote Rossiter, was to build the foundations of a new empire that could reach, quote, reach out forcefully and benevolently to every person, end quote. Forceful and benevolent government. That's the government we know and love today, right? It's forceful and it's benevolent. So that's Hamilton for you. Morris, who's his boss and a very influential figure in his life. And again, there's a lot of reasons to believe that Hamilton essentially worked for Morris and other connected, very, very wealthy and connected businessmen. In addition to war profiteering, Morris agitated for and finally got through Continental Congress the Bank of North America. The proto-central bank, despite lavish, and I'm reading here, these are my notes, but, bear with me. Despite lavish monopolistic privileges bestowed upon the Bank of North America by Congress, his bank only lasted for 1 year. His notes, which he naturally overissued, rapidly depreciated despite their legal tender status. So he got Congress to give him a quasi-monopoly on the issue of notes, but he had to sell his bank in 1783. He went bust. how he ran his bank is very interesting. Listen to this. Quote, when Morris failed to raise the legally required specie capital, and that means gold and silver in his vaults, to launch the Bank of North America, Morris, in an act of an act tantamount to embezzlement, simply appropriated specie loaned to the U.S. by France and invested it for the government in his own bank. He just grabbed that silver and put it in his bank and called it his capital. Nice job if you can get it. In this way, the bulk of specie capital for his bank was appropriated by Morris out of government funds. A multiple of these funds was then borrowed back from Morris's bank by Morris as a government financier for the pecuniary benefit of Morris as a banker. And finally, Morris channeled most of the money into war contracts for his friends and business associates. So on the one hand, he is a government official of some sort. He's influential on the committee during the war. On the other hand, he's a banker. And on yet another hand, he's a merchant. So the Morris, the political figure, gives the money to Morris the banker. Morris the banker loans the money and channels the money into war contracts of Morris the merchant. Very interesting. This is from Murray Rothbard, Conceived in Liberty, Volume 4, which I recommend that you read. It's one of the most fascinating books on American history you'll ever find, Conceived in Liberty. So this is the kind of people we're dealing with here. They were very, very upset with how little power the federal government had, the central government had under the Articles of Confederation, wanted to push for a more centralized constitution. Look, they couldn't even tax anybody. What kind of government is that? It couldn't even tax anybody. They had to go begging to state governments, to state legislatures, and they couldn't force the states to do anything that the states didn't want to do. Who would be happy with this kind of power? Not Hamilton. Of course they wanted more. So anyway, back to the bond story, right? So one of the events that prompted the Constitutional Convention and the eventual adoption of the Constitution was the Shays Rebellion in Massachusetts. And it's pretty important. Shays Rebellion was a characteristic symptom of what these people wanted and why they wanted it. The Shays Rebellion, I'm not going to go into detail. There's a lot of material out there. You know, look for the real story behind Shays Rebellion on YouTube, and you will get a clip of a speech given by Tom Woods. If you search a little longer, you'll find a long article, almost a short book, on Shays Rebellion by Gary North. A lot of fascinating information in there. But anyway, it was triggered by a sharp rise in regressive taxes. The taxes themselves were increased as a part to repay the state debt, right? In less than 10 years. They wanted to repay the Massachusetts state debt in less than 10 years and enrich the few at the expense of the many because of what I explained above. You know, the moneyed interest had accumulated, had bought up the bonds, pennies on the dollar, and now they wanted to get more than they paid. So, the money to pay the people who were holding the bonds now had to come from taxes on the people who didn't hold them anymore, means the poor farmers. So, in a word, state governments were under pressure from large bondholders, wealthy merchants, politically connected merchants, to collect taxes from preferably poor people. It didn't make sense to tax them, the rich merchants, to pay them themselves, to be able to pay them the nominal value of the bonds, not the 3-5% that it was trading at. And by the way, again, the 3-5% of face value trading price of those bonds reflected the people's forecast of how much the bonds would be repaid. And by accepting that price, you accepted that whatever you financed by buying that bond, that is gone. It's gone. You're not getting it back. So they wanted a nominal value. The Massachusetts government tried. They had rebellion on their hands. It was a tax revolt. The farmers of Massachusetts backcountry rebelled because, in their opinion, they were fighting an unjust government. They were the victims of a regressive tax system and overly expensive and complicated judicial system, the courts. And they were not adequately represented in the Massachusetts government, which was dominated by the Boston gentry and was unresponsive to their needs in any meaningful way. So, in short, the rebellion was exactly in the spirit of revolution. They saw themselves fighting against the tyrannical government in the Massachusetts state, in their own words. That's to quote one of their statements. They were fighting tyrannical government in the Massachusetts states. In other words, that state was no better than the British. They had just kicked off the continent, right? So they had approximately 4,000 rebels under the command of Daniel Shea, you know, the Revolutionary War captain. It had a lot of popular support in Western Massachusetts. Even those who didn't actively take up arms were sympathetic to the rebel cause. Indeed, nearly all of the citizen militia either refused to suppress the rebellion or joined forces. Refused to suppress the rebellion or joined forces with the rebels. And the authorities in Boston were very aware of this and very afraid. Okay. Now, a quick note on public debt. What is a public debt? public debt, perpetual public debt or government debt, is equivalent to forced labor. And this is a thought that was voiced many times by people like Murray Rothbard and Tom DiLorenzo and others. But I want to repeat it. I think it's a very important point. So citizens are forced to work and pay taxes to pay off the principal and interest on the national debt. Interesting, right? Somebody else incurred the debt. Now you're forced to fork over your property, what you make through your contract with your employer or your customer. The government has nothing to do with that. Yet they come in and say, okay, we're going to take 20, 30, 40, 50%, whatever the number is. It doesn't matter what the number is. But we're taking that money. It's ours now, right? To pay off our debt. The debt that somebody else incurred. Let's say, you know, imagine you're working in your yard. I don't know. You're growing tomatoes or whatever. And somebody comes in and says, a person you don't know, a person you don't owe anything to. They say, look, what happened is I incurred a debt. So you're person A. Person B comes in and says, I incurred a debt to person C, and I can't pay it back, so I'm going to take your stuff, person A's stuff, to pay C. Well, A didn't have anything to do with the contract between B and C, but now they're you know, with the government taxing people to pay off the debt, it's slave labor. They're making people work in order to repay something that they had no connection to. It's not their obligation. They were not the entity that took that obligation on. And the politicians, again, they have no personal obligation to pay anyone anything when they vote to spend more than the tax revenues can support, right? But today's citizens are essentially, again, turned into tax slaves, tax serfs, by a large national debt. And so are the future generations. If my information is correct, the British are still paying off the national debt incurred in the 18th century during the French and Indian War, the Seven Years' War. It's more than 200 years ago. So it's not just our children and grandchildren are going to be, you know, burdened with the debt that the Washington politicians incur today. No. It's 220 years into the future, 240 years into the future. You're still going to be, your children are still going to be, your children's 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 grandchildren are going to be forced to work to pay off that debt that is being incurred today as we speak. That's the reality of national debt. So the tax rebels, in my mind, and again, many of them bore losses because of the depreciation of those state bonds. They were paid in those bonds. A lot of the Revolutionary War veterans were paid in those bonds because the government didn't have the money. So essentially, they wrote them IOUs. You know, I can't pay you now, but I will pay you later. And they, when they sold those bonds, they demonstrated that, like, okay, they won't pay me, but at least I can get something for this now. They were absolutely justified in their action against the Massachusetts government, in my mind. You know, when in the course of human events, you know, read the Declaration again. What they did was very, very similar to what the American colonies did to the British. Okay, so why am I talking about this? Because there's a connection. There's a connection between pushing for a centralized government and this bond story, the state debts. One of the first things that Hamilton did after the adoption of the Constitution, as we're going to see, is he pushed for, in his capacity as the newly appointed Secretary of the Treasury, which was also a funny story, like somebody, Morris recommended him to Washington for Treasury Secretary. And Washington said, what? I didn't know he knew anything about finance. Okay, well, Morris seems to be a rich guy. He knows his way around money. You know, if he thinks you're a good candidate, sure, why not? So, you know, Washington was sort of a simpleton in that regard. But he was more than a simpleton. But we'll get into that later, maybe, by the time. So he, as the new Secretary of the Treasury, what he did was push for the assumption by the United States of the state debts. In fact, that was probably one of the bigger motives behind pushing for the new Constitution and the new central government. So what it means is the federal government now says, okay, we will assume the debt. We will pay off the nominal value of all those bonds to whoever happens to hold them. The federal government needs to do that. And of course, if you're going to assume obligations like that, you need to provide yourself with a mechanism to come up with the money. Therefore, the central government had to have direct taxing power. Unlike the government under the Articles, which didn't, only the state governments could do that. And the Congress needed to go to the states to beg for money, to ask for money. But the feds promised to repay those bonds at par, all right? That was the swindle of the century. And there's a huge story described in detail, in loving detail, by Tommy DiLorenzo in a number of occasions, a number of lectures and some articles, how, talk about insider trading, which, by the way, I've I don't think it's a crime to trade on the information that you have, but it's a crime if that information relies on the coercive action of a government. So that was the ultimate insider trade. Very few connected individuals traveled up and down, and those individuals connected congressmen, you know, included congressmen, senators, and connected people. They traveled up and down the Eastern Seaboard with huge sacks of money, and by money I mean gold, buying up those bonds, whatever, you know, bonds remained to be bought up, because they knew that in a week or in 4 weeks or in a couple of months, a law would be passed that would give them the nominal value. So if you're buying it off at 3%, you're making, you know, you're paying 3 cents on a dollar and you're getting a full dollar back. That's like a 30 time return on your investment in a very short time. And people made millions, gazillions of dollars, okay? Including Hamilton, who made a few million dollars by today's standards. Even I'm not sure what the actual nominal sum was in those days' money. I'm not sure, but in today's money, absolutely millions. And Morris made $40 million, I think, through that one scheme alone. Okay, it was a swindle of the century. So the newly elected members of Congress, who knew it was going to go down, right? They traveled for weeks up and down the Eastern Seaboard buying the bonds from the veterans, in full knowledge that they would soon get the 100% from the federal government that is assuming that debt a few short weeks later. Okay. So that was one of the first things that Hamilton did for himself and his buddies. Doesn't that tell you something about, you know, this new instrument, the Constitution, and this new entity that they created? That at least it's dangerous. Something like this could be done. They couldn't be done before, but now they could do it. And look, if you see that kind of financial motivation, my first thought is that's why they did it. Okay? If you see something happen and, you know, there's a lot of debate going back and forth and finally one group wins and they, you know, they get their way and this happens and a small group of people makes a ton of money on that, there might be a connection between those people making a lot of money. That money making being made possible by the preceding event, in that case, the passing of the Constitution. But moving on, so Hamilton's grand vision was the glory of the British Empire, of the new empire without the British. He again disrespected Jefferson, people like him, who believed that the primary purpose of government was the defense of life, liberty, and property. Excessive concern for liberty, we talked about that before. He thought it was ridiculous and bad of Jefferson to be concerned with that. Hamilton and the Federalists, they understood that the mercantilist empire was a bad thing if you're on the paying end of it, but it's a very, very nice thing if you're on the receiving end. You know, so the colonies were on the bad end, on the paying end, they rebelled. But if you're on the receiving end, it's a different story. It's great. It's great. It's good to be king. It's very nice to have that kind of power. So basically, to achieve that vision, Hamilton and his buddies, they wanted to have a corrupt and pet legislature, make it subservient to the executive branch, so that the executive branch can go about building that empire and reaping the benefits of, you know, being a mercantilist empire. This bond thing was beautiful. I'll give him that. That was beautiful. But you can only pull it off once, right? There's only one, you know, like nationwide assumption of state debt. That's it. They wiped out. The debts are no more. So what do you do then? You know, he wanted what Jefferson called later a permanent engine of corruption. That is why the very next thing in his agenda was to establish a central bank, a la the Bank of England. The story that everybody's heard, where, you know, Jefferson asked him where in the Constitution specifically he can find the authorization for the establishment of a central bank. And by the way, the ratification convention discussed a bank and they rejected it, and then they adopted a constitution. So it's pretty safe to assume that they didn't want the central bank. However you may want to interpret the constitution, it's not in there directly, and the ratification happened in the states, but the drafters of the constitution rejected the idea. It's pretty safe to say that they didn't, you know, the constitution didn't authorize it. But yet Hamilton said that Jefferson said, where in the Constitution do you find this authority to create the bank? He said, read between the lines. Jefferson said that he had read between the lines and that there's blank space there, which I think is, I don't know if it happened or not, but if it did, it would have been awesome. But Washington was persuaded to throw his support behind the bank, and how they did that was very simple. He, you know, Mount Vernon, his estate, was, you know, outside the District of Columbia that they were charting at the time. And they told him, okay, look, he really wanted his estate to border the District of Columbia for the sake of real estate values, obviously. You know, if you're right on the border, it's going to be better than if you're further out in the woods somewhere. And they said they moved the District of Columbia. They redrew the map of the District of Columbia to give him this, what he wanted, to redraw the District of Columbia so that Mount Vernon, in fact, did border it. And in return for that, he said, okay, I'll support the bank. And he supported it, and everyone's happy, right? how can the Founding Fathers be so corrupt? Well, yeah, they were. You think they're not human or something? Of course they were corrupt. So, again, they were tirelessly pushing for a more powerful central government, Federalists, Hamilton and his buddies. Jefferson hated Hamilton, and it was, you know, the feeling was mutual. He considered Hamilton to be the traitor to the revolution. I wonder if he had a good reason for that, you know. Permanent engine of corruption, that's a pretty strong indictment. Also, Hamilton actually relentlessly supported and championed a large national debt for the sake of having a large national debt. And the reason for this was, in his mind, very simple. Look, the holders of the government bonds are going to be rich people, and therefore the rich people are going to be, are going to have a direct stake in making sure that the government remains in business, therefore, you know, which means remains active, powerful, and capable of collecting taxes. So they will support the government. And they will support the government's taxing powers and other powers that it will, you know, choose to pursue in order to be able to collect taxes. Because, again, it's going to be in those connected people's direct financial interest for the government to remain in power and to remain in business. That's, you know, not bad thinking. I mean, I think it's morally disgusting, but, you know, that was his thinking. And he's right, of course. So there's Hamilton for you. And so the Federalists, they used Shays' Rebellion, which I believe, again, was completely justified. They used it and other similar events, because it wasn't the only tax revolts. There were tax revolts in New Jersey, Maryland, Virginia, South Carolina, other tax revolts. They used that to create fears of future insurrections, and they used those fears to make influential politicians and, the richer people of the society at the time to think that their power and their money was slipping away from them, that they will be swept away by rebels, and there's not going to be a law and order, and and by the way, you're never going to see your bond money again. Madison himself later admitted that this souring creditor status, to quote the Hologram of Liberty by Boston Tea Party, contributed more to the uneasiness which produced the Constitution and prepared the mind for a general reform than any inadequacies in the Articles of Confederation. Again, this situation with the debt and tax revolts around the attempts to collect the debt, or to repay the debt, contributed more to the uneasiness which produced the Constitution and prepared the mind, I wonder whose mind we're talking about here, for a general reform. So it was always about the money. It was never about a principle. It was always about the money, which is only natural. It's actually a pretty good explanation, you know. Follow the money is a very good principle if you're trying to investigate any kind of event. And so they call the convention, and the rest of history is history. But, you know, let's look at the very briefly at the convention itself. And again, I'm going to read off my notes, mostly in the interest of time, to avoid going off on tangents again. So let's see. The convention was not actually called to abolish the existing Constitution. It was specifically called to revise the Articles of Confederation, and the state legislatures delegated their representatives to the convention for this express purpose. That was their mandate, and nothing else. Imagine their surprise when they were told that, no, we're not amending the Articles. In fact, we're throwing them away, and we're going to vote on a completely new document. In that sense, the convention was essentially a coup d'etat. It was a coup d'etat, okay? Of the 55 delegates who initially arrived at the convention, 41 were politicians and 34 were lawyers. Lawyers. This group was much different from the revolutionaries in the 1770s. Only 8 of those at the convention had signed the Declaration of Independence, and 6, only 6, signed the Articles of Confederation. The famous revolutionaries were not delegates. Jefferson and Adams weren't there. They were in Europe. Patrick Henry, you know, of the Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death fame, had refused to participate because, like you said, I smelled a rat. Thomas Paine, Sam Adams, and Christopher Gadsden weren't even invited. Okay, So again, this was not done by the same people who did the revolution or fought for independence. 14 out of 55 delegates would later quit, largely because of the convention's blatant disregard for the state's mandate. Again, they were lured to Philadelphia on false pretenses, and then when they showed up, they were told, no, we're doing something different. And 14 of 55 people said, fuck this, we're not doing this, we're leaving, this is insane. Again, the delegates had not been charged by their respective states to scrap the articles. It's like your wife sends you out to the grocery store and you come back with, you know, having bought a new house or a new car, and she's just going to kill you. So again, 14 quit. So initially, they invited 74 people, 74 delegates. 19 refused. 55 showed up. 14 out of the 55 later quit in disgust. Of the remaining 41, 3 refused to sign the resulting document. They refused to sign the draft of the Constitution. So what we have here is 39 people out of 74, and that's 53%, almost half, just over half. 39 people of those initially invited to attend the secret convention, it was very secret, deciding for all the sovereign peoples of all 13 states to scrap their existing constitution in clear violation of that constitution, because the constitution could only be amended by unanimous agreement of all states. You know, 53% of the invited 74 people is not a unanimous consent of all 13 states. Very nice. It was a coup d'etat. Okay, Article 13, Section 1 of the Articles required the unanimous vote of the states for alteration of that document, which was otherwise deemed perpetual. The new constitution circumvented that by the 9 out of 13 requirements for ratification. Yeah, the new constitution, you know, old articles become null and void if 9 out of 13 vote for the new constitution. Well, that's in violation of the constitution they had at the time. Clear-cut coup d'etat. At the Constitutional Convention, Hamilton presented the first draft of the Constitution, which was very revealing, I think, about the Federalist's real agenda bent on centralization of power. His plan included a president for life who would appoint governors. Now, again, 13 independent countries electing their governments and governors and legislatures and whatever. They want a president for life appointing the governors, erasing thereby the 13 sovereign countries and reducing them to the status of administrative districts, pretty much what we have today, I would argue. And who would have the veto power over all state legislation, effectively killing the ability of the people of the states to decide their own affairs through their legislative bodies. His Jeffersonian detractors openly accused him for asking for a king, and of course they were right. So keep this in mind. This is being driven by people who had these kinds of ideas, okay, about the new central government. That's what they wanted. That's what they wrote that draft for. That's what they wanted. They were defeated the first round, but that's what they wanted. Keep this in mind, okay? Later during the ratification period, Hamilton lied, of course, through his teeth in the Federalist Papers, trying to sell the Constitution to the people of the state of New York. He spoke favorably about the state's rights and federalism. We know he lied. How? Because his original proposal was for a permanent king-like president. And that proposal would have destroyed any semblance of true federalism or divided sovereignty, as James Madison put it. So, you know, just a short while ago, he wanted to eliminate federalism. Now he's in favor of federalism. Do you think he changed his mind? I don't think so. I think he lied. And why did he lie? Because he knew that if the Constitution were to be adopted, he could circumvent whatever provisions for states' rights the Constitution seemed to have, which, of course, is what happened. But this is something to keep in mind. Okay, I don't think people of this kind change their mind easily. I don't think if you know, you can stop desiring that kind of power if you're already bent on getting it. It just doesn't happen in real life. Give me one example from history of someone who wanted a dictatorship and then later changed his mind, decided to give it up. You know, people who speak for freedom can later become corrupted by power, but vice versa, you know, the other way around, I haven't seen it happen. Okay. All in all, the convention took place in almost total secrecy. Windows were nailed shut, doors locked, delegates sworn to strict silence. The journal of the proceedings was first published 32 years later. A whole generation later. Madison's notes were not published until 53 years later, in 1840. Okay? What reasons would you have for such secrecy? Why? I don't know about you, but to me, you know, pretty clearly, this looks and smells and sounds like a group of people who knew what they were doing, and they knew that whatever they were doing would not fly with the general public if the public were aware of it. You know? And if it walks like a duck, walks like a duck. Think about it. Think about it. They shut themselves up for weeks, months. In that room, they, you know, they were sworn to secrecy. They couldn't disclose to anybody what they were doing. Why not? It was so good for the people they were doing in that room. Okay, so now to the objections at the time. I don't have time to go to a lot of detail, but there is a lot of detail there. I would just ask you to, you know, get a copy of the Anti-Federalist Papers. Just get a copy. You can buy that book on Amazon or wherever. Seriously, if you read it, you know, most everything these guys are writing in the Anti-Federalist Papers, it's all reality now. It's all happened. It's amazing and frightening at the same time to think that they could see ahead that far. One of the examples of the Federalist propaganda and the anti-Federalist criticism is the Battle for the Bill of Rights. In Federalist 84, Hamilton argued that Bills of Rights are not only unnecessary in the proposed Constitution, but would even be dangerous. They would contain various exceptions to the power not granted, and on this very account would afford a colorable pretext to claim more than were granted. For why declare that things shall not be done which there is no power to do? Why, for instance, should it be said that the liberty of the press shall not be restrained, where no power is given by which restrictions may be imposed? It would furnish, to men disposed to usurp, a plausible premise for claiming that power. They might urge with a semblance of reason that the provision against restraining the liberty of the press afforded a clear implication that a power to prescribe proper regulations concerning it was intended to be vested in the national government. So basically he's saying, look, the Constitution is very strict already. You know, it says it only gives enumerated powers. So by definition, you know, something that's not on that list, Article 1, Section 8, is not a power of the federal government. Why then specify that the freedom of the speech and, you know, freedom of assembly and, you know, freedom of petition to government for redress of grievances and things like that, why specify that those things are forbidden to the federal government, or the right to keep and bear arms? It's already clear that it's forbidden. Well, okay. You know, anti-federalists, by the way, disagree. If everything which is not given to the federal government is reserved to the people, what propriety is there in these exceptions? Does the Constitution anywhere grant the power of suspending the habeas corpus to make ex post facto laws? It certainly does not in express terms. The only answer that can be given is that these are implied in the general powers granted. All the powers which the Bills of Rights guard against the abuse of are contained or implied in the general ones granted by this Constitution, which reaches to everything which concerns human happiness, life, liberty, and property. The exercise of power in this case should be restrained within proper limits. Of course, they're right. You know, look at all those, you know, general welfare and interstate commerce provisions, just to name the two, that were not just loopholes. There were holes you could drive an armored tank division through, and they have to pass any and all sorts of legislation that, if you're a strict constructionist and you're just looking at the enumerated powers, are clearly not on the list of enumerated powers, and yet they were able to do it. And thank God that we have the Bill of Rights. And even with the Bill of Rights, what, you know, you think we have freedom of speech? you think in the state of New Jersey where I live, we have, you know, the right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed? Oh, it is infringed. I can bear arms. I can't. In principle, there is, you know, there is a mechanism in principle provided for in the state of New Jersey for people to receive concealed carry permits. But fat chance getting it, you know, good luck, go try. It's not going to happen. So, you know, my right is being infringed very clearly, and yet we have the Second Amendment. Imagine if they had no Second Amendment whatsoever. What would happen then? So, of course, the anti-federalists were right. And Hamilton and Madison who were advocating, or Hamilton in arguing against the Bill of Rights was of course wrong. So that's that for you. So, you know, look, imagine not having the First Amendment, right? Americans are being assassinated by the federal governments already today without any indictment, judge, jury, verdict, process of law, you know, the Fourth Amendment, nothing. Obama has a kill list. Oh, they're calling it now the disposition matrix. Fancier name for a kill list. Okay, your home can be legally searched without a warrant signed by a judge. The FBI can write their own, search your place, and not even tell you about it. Or if you know about it, they can forbid you to tell anybody else. And if you do, you will go to jail. And all of that with the Fourth Amendment. Imagine how great life would be without the Fourth Amendment. So let me ask you again: who was right? Who was right? The Federalists or the Anti-Federalists? It's pretty clear to me the Anti-Federalists were right. You know, you shall know them by their fruit, as they say. On to the next point. So the Federalists were unfortunately much better organized than the Anti-Federalists. The Anti-Federalists were mostly rural, small-time farmers that didn't have internet or TV, and the news of the developments reached remote areas slowly, many times too late. The centralizers, the Federalists, were mostly concentrated in larger cities and tended to be very wealthy, merchants, bankers, and so forth. They had their propaganda at the ready, and they were very, very good at it too. Anti-Federalists were mostly unprepared and taken by surprise, and they lost. Not too much time to go into the ratification process, but generally ratifications were by the states were a joke. The Federalists were urging the states to ratify quickly, ridiculing the Anti-Federalists who were cautioning the people to spend more time thinking and reading the document. When someone is telling you to do something right now, before it's too late, quickly, without thinking, without stopping, what does it usually tell you? Okay. The propaganda of the Federalists was enormous. Debates and discussions of the new document before its ratification were massively discouraged. The ratification conventions were rushed through very quickly. The only state where the new constitution was put to any general public debate was Rhode Island. Rhode Island and North Carolina held out the longest, by the way. Rhode Island popular vote was against the ratification 11-1. They put it out on a referendum and the constitution lost 11-1. Okay. And the Senate was putting a lot of pressure on Rhode Island. Eventually what they did... when Rhode Island didn't yield, and it was proposing very strongly some clarifying amendments to be adopted before they would ratify and join the union. So what they do, what did the newly formed federal government do? In May 1790, they voted to embargo all trade with Rhode Island. Okay. This great constitution that is such a blessing to everybody. It was such a blessing that it had to be forced down Rhode Island's throat by a blockade. By an embargo, all right? They did embargo. It was a total embargo. It's worse than what the U.S. is doing to Iran right now, okay? So imagine Rhode Island was thought of as Iran. Yeah, it didn't have a nuclear weapon or a nuclear program, but they were dealt with more severely than Iran is being dealt with right now. So under that pressure, 11 days later, they folded and they ratified. Okay, so Constitution. The idea is so great for everyone, they had to twist arms and break arms to get it ratified, okay? Just keep that image in your mind. The language of the Constitution was left ambiguous, and I think it was done on purpose, of course. Why do I think so? Well, okay. See, the article said that the federal government only had powers expressly delegated to it by the states. So when the language of the new Constitution was being discussed, someone noticed that the word expressly had been dropped, and it was just said delegated by the states. So, I moved to amend and add the word expressly before the word delegated by the states to read expressly delegated by the states. And who then but our very own James Madison gets up and says, no, that's not, we shouldn't do that. We can't do that. We can't bind the new government with these petty restrictions. Otherwise, how will it carry out its function? If for any move that it needs to make, it'll need a specific law. That's not going to work. If it doesn't have an expressly delegated power, and yet it needs a certain power to carry out its function, so it won't be able to carry out its function. So the necessary and proper language, right? Came into being that way. So I don't know. Look, I don't know if it would have made a lot of difference if the word expressly was left there. They would find another way around it. But that's an example of what they did. They left it vague in order to keep the general and undefined powers expandable in the future, which is, of course, what happened. Now, very interestingly, the Constitution said nothing about who and how shall interpret the constitutionality of the actions of the new government. When the government does something, who's to say whether or not it's within the Constitution? I don't know. The modern understanding of Americans is, well, of course, the Supreme Court does that. That's their function. They, they determine the constitutionality of the government's action. But wait, okay, so Supreme Court, which is part of the federal government, will determine whether federal government is being constitutional or not. That's nice. That's nice. If you suggested to any of the founders at the time that, especially revolutionaries who fought the war, fought for independence and stuff, that the Constitution should be designed in such a way that the constraints on the power of government, which is the same as the fate of liberty, as we've discussed before, will be decided by 5 government lawyers with lifetime tenure, and that's the majority of the Supreme Court, that's all you need. 5 government lawyers with lifetime tenure, that's the design. They would laugh you out of town. Okay? But notice that the Constitution doesn't say anything on it. All right? An example of ambiguity, no private property should be taken for public use without just compensation. Well, just compensation is what? Public use is what? There's no definition of public use. There's no definition of just compensation. Nobody knows what it means. And yet it's there. So, the real answer is, of course, whatever they decide public use means, and whatever they decide the just compensation is. Look up the Kelo case, Kelo. Supreme Court said it was A-OK to take private property, grab it, and give it to a private developer. Okay, Now, so by their fruits, so to speak. So look at the new powers. Power to tax Americans directly. Power to spend money and take on debt. Power to regulate interstate commerce, whatever regulate means. Well, actually, power to do pretty much anything. As long as a clever government lawyer can put together an argument saying that this is for the general welfare. That's the reality of what the Constitution gave this new country. So, you know, and look at two things that they did. The Alien and Sedition Act, right after, just a few years later, Alien and Sedition Act and the Whiskey Rebellion. The Whiskey Rebellion was, you know, followed, the imposition of excise tax on whiskey. Whiskey was being used in Western Pennsylvania as money by many people. It's as though, you know, imagine somebody taxes money, just the fact that you use money for transactions, they tax that. Of course, they went nuts and they ran the tax collectors out of town. And Hamilton agitated like crazy for Washington to lead an army of 13,000 men to go there and crush the rebellion. That was the first action of the U.S. military, by the way, after the Constitution. They crushed the rebellion. That's what they needed the standing army for. That's what they needed the army for. As Bob Higgs says, governments need money to pay soldiers to kill people. And the reverse of that is also true. Governments need soldiers to make people pay. That's what happens. That the first thing they did, the first act of the U.S. military, was against Americans who didn't see anything useful coming out of the federal government that, you know, that they could name. They saw no value to themselves in this new government. And yet they were being, you know, asked or not asked, they were being told that they were going to be paying for it, this whiskey tax. So $13,000. So they caught a few people. Some, you know, they were tried and even convicted. But Washington pardoned them. Hamilton was agitating for the death penalty. He wanted them hanged. Okay? That's why Hamilton was such a fan of standing armies again, I think. So he wanted them hanged for treason. So not paying an outrageous tax, and it was outrageous to those people, is treason. Okay? And Alien and Sedition Act. Like, the ink was barely dry on the Bill of Rights. Which says, among other things, that government shall not, Congress shall pass no law restricting freedom of speech. The ink was barely dry when they go ahead and pass a law restricting freedom of speech, Alien Sedition Act. Okay, I think my case is pretty clear. The U.S. Constitution was not conceived of as an instrument of safeguarding liberty. It was conceived of as an instrument of augmenting the power of government and centralizing that power in the new federal government, or rather the nationalist government. The people who pushed for it were open advocates of things that are antithetical to freedom. The way it was put together and then ratified is abhorrent and morally despicable. It was dishonest. It was basically forced on the population of unsuspecting Americans. So stop conflating freedom and American ideal with the U.S. Constitution. The U.S. Constitution was treason to the Revolution. The U.S. Constitution was a huge step back for liberty compared to, you know, the weak and the Confederation, the loose Confederation that they had after the Revolution. I think that's pretty much what I wanted to say. Oh my God, it's an hour and 22 minutes. An hour and 23 minutes. Well, if you're not asleep, thank you.